Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Redesign Your Mind, the Breakthrough Program for Real Cognitive Change by Eric Maisel, PhD. Narrated by Stephen Bowlby. Foreword. As a psychologist, academic, and author for 40 years, I have read my share of books designed to help in life. A few boxes must be checked to recommend a book. It must be practical and straightforward to apply, immediately applicable, innovative, not put the audience to sleep, increase peace of mind, and expand awareness. Frankly, most books fall far short. In contrast, Dr. Eric Maisel checks all the boxes with Redesign Your Mind. You are what you think. It doesn't get more straightforward than this. But sometimes simple truths become overly complicated theories, and such is the case with many books on cognitive behavioral therapy, CBT. As a result, many books on CBT are, to be blunt, dull. Dr. Maisel's book is anything but boring. Additionally, although many other books describe CBT well, they read like a cookbook, far from experiencing the many facets of the actual meal. In Redesign Your Mind, we not only learn about cognitive psychology, but we also experience what it is like to have a mind, specifically, what it feels like to inhabit in our own mind. Dr. Maisel is not a newbie to this subject. His decades of work have profoundly affected the thinking and quality of life of countless individuals worldwide. In his latest book, we not only get insight into how we think, we obtain skills to discover who we are and what we are here to do. This book will help you see both the problems in the way you think and the solutions. And before you know it, you will be stepping forward with unique honesty and the ability to free yourself from old dysfunctional patterns. For years, you may have been unknowingly building busy walls with your thoughts and imprisoning yourself behind them. By practicing the exercises in this book, you will be reaching the core of who you are in remarkable new ways, and learning that amid your most significant challenges, you can become more calm, effective, and aware of your power to free yourself. You are, quite literally, about to see with renewed clarity and move beyond concepts and constructs in your mind that caused you to behave in ways that limited your happiness and success. By the end of this book, if you practice the exercises, you will discover your mind is extraordinary in what it can create. Whenever I have a chance to talk with a fellow author, I ask them what they wish for the audience, which tells me a great deal. Dr. Maisel eloquently answered me, "The book goes deeper than just managing your thoughts. It changes the very source of your thoughts, the room that is your mind, so that you no longer think thoughts that aren't serving you. You end up with a much fresher, breezier, nimbler mind." I love this answer, and after reading this book, I can tell you that Eric more than achieves his goal. If you believe that you are just a product of the world around you, that your happiness is dependent on this thing or that person, then you are always going to be a victim of circumstance to one degree or another. One of the most liberating personal discoveries you will make is knowing that whenever you are upset, you have the power to shift your thinking and discover a peace you never knew existed. When you are unsettled, you most likely don't quickly see the real cause of your upset or the solution. This book helps you stop wasting your life wishing for a better past, blaming your present circumstances, or blindly hoping for a better future. In short, the practice of the exercises frees you to create, grow, succeed, and love. Gerald Jampolsky, M.D. Introduction. Let's get you a whole new mind, shall we? It would be lovely if you could do a better job of dealing with all those thoughts that aren't serving you. That alone would be a really useful upgrade. But what if you could go a giant step further and stop those thoughts from even entering your mind? Wouldn't that be the best? Well, you can do exactly that. For thousands of years, philosophers have tried to describe consciousness and explain how the mind works, but we aren't going down that road. We are opting for a super simple, super useful model. We are going to picture your mind as a room that you inhabit. I'm inviting you to think of it as a literal place where you go to think and be. That's the metaphor we're going to use and the picture we're going to paint. And indeed, the room that is your mind is the most important place in your universe. Now, probably for the first time, you get to redesign it, redecorate it, and really take charge of it. As you do, you will start thinking and feeling differently about your life. Just picture the difference between a bright, sunny room and a drab, claustrophobic room. In which one do you want to live? Wouldn't you be quite the different person if you got to leave that drab one where you've been living your whole life long and start living in that bright one? Wouldn't that make a tremendous difference in how you thought and felt? Of course it would. Starting right now, I'd like for you to believe that you can redesign and redecorate the room that is your mind. Why shouldn't you be able to? You're in charge of that room, aren't you? So what exactly are we doing? We're visualizing change. I want you to see that room, really picture it, and get behind making changes to it. You can decide later if this process has actually worked. The first step is to give it a try. Here's what I'd like you to do first. Get yourself a journal or open a file on your computer dedicated to our work together. I'll be providing you with a writing prompt at the end of each chapter, and I hope that you'll take the time to respond to those prompts. Here is the first one. I've been living in the room that is my mind my whole life. What has that felt like? If you took the time to write, I hope that you've already learned a little something about what living in your particular mind has felt like. Maybe you didn't really have adequate language to describe how living there has felt. That's okay. If you tried your best to capture some of your experience living in your own mind, that's great. That's all I'm asking, for you to engage with these ideas. Let's try a second writing exercise. In a moment, I'll ask you to describe your indwelling style. What do I mean by that? Picture a country cottage versus an ultra-modern home. Each has a different style. You can easily picture the decorations in one versus the decorations in the other. The cottage might have carved wooden picture frames, and the modern home may have brushed steel ones. In each, everything would hang together because there was an overarching style or theme. Well, the way we inhabit the room that is our mind has its own particular style. What's yours? Maybe you're always a little frightened and anxious in there, so you have an anxious indwelling style. Maybe you're very critical and self-critical, a critical indwelling style. Maybe you're always right on the verge of anger or right on the verge of sadness, so you have an angry indwelling style or a despondent indwelling style. What is your way of being in the room that is your mind? What's your indwelling style? Take a nice amount of time and respond to this question. Remember, the goal isn't to arrive at the right answer or perfect understanding. The goal is to begin getting familiar with these ideas. This may be the first time you've ever thought about the possibility of redesigning your mind. I hope that it's a little thrilling. Be easy at the start and keep jotting down ideas as they come to you. Those will be really fertile areas to investigate. Now that you've gotten your feet wet thinking about the room that is your mind and your indwelling style, let's address exactly what you'll be doing. You're going to visit the room that is your mind and make changes. Not every change I suggest will apply to you or even make sense to you, so only make the changes that seem sensible to make. I ask that you at least consider each change before rejecting it. I've worked with clients as a therapist and a coach for 40 years, and each change I'm suggesting has its reasons. I think you'll see the logic to every change I suggest, so please do give each one some thought. And please, have some fun. We are doing serious work, but we can also be a little lighthearted. You will see that there's a little cheeky joy built into each of my suggestions. I want this work to feel like the equivalent of a breath of fresh air, so add your own cheekiness and joy. Imagine wandering about in some great flea market on the lookout for just the right doodads for your newly designed mind. The steering wheel of a great ship? No, not quite. Those gorgeous brandy snifters from Vienna? No, not quite. But those French posters from the 1940s? They might be exactly right. First as a therapist, and for the last 30 years as a creativity coach, I've worked with creative and performing artists, scientists and engineers, academics and entrepreneurs, and other bright, imaginative clients. All have been troubled, and most have ended up with some mental disorder label, maybe depression, bipolar, attention deficit, or generalized anxiety. All smart, sensitive, creative people are troubled enough to earn some mental disorder label. That's because there is a necessary connection between intelligence, sensitivity, creativity, and distress. Being smart, sensitive, creative, and troubled go hand in hand. What can be done to help with that? Many things, but one is by far the most important, the one that you have direct control over. You can get a grip on your own mind. Philosophers from Marcus Aurelius to the Buddha have pointed this out as our top priority. Cognitive behavioral therapy, CBT, is the modern way that this age-old message is delivered. Why is CBT so popular that it's the primary therapy provided by the United Kingdom's National Health Service? Because its central message is indubitably true. You are what you think. However, the ways that you're invited to get a grip on your mind, whether those invitations come from Stoicism, Buddhism, or cognitive behavioral therapy, are a bit on the dull and stodgy side. And they miss a crucial point. A major shortcoming of CBT is that it doesn't speak to what it feels like to have a mind. We don't just have thoughts. We keenly experience what it feels like to dwell in our own mind. Descartes pictured it as a stage where we play out our dramas. We're going to picture it as a room, one you can design and decorate exactly as you like. The room that is your mind isn't some optional accessory to life. It is where and how human consciousness is experienced. It is all important, and it's yours to create and design. It's really exciting to picture transforming that room into exactly the kind of place where you would want to live. When you redesign your mind, you increase your creativity, heal from past trauma, and achieve emotional well-being. You really change. Come join me on this mind-changing adventure, and let's have some fun. Part 1. Redesigning Your Mind. Chapter 1. Letting a breeze in. We are not going to trouble ourselves with arcane debates about what consciousness is, where it's located, or whether the brain and the mind are exactly the same or seriously different things. We are focusing on one beautiful idea. The room that is your mind can be redesigned to serve you better. The first thing we're going to do is get all that stuffiness out of your mind room. The phrase, the room that is your mind, is a bit cumbersome, so let's use mind room instead. You've been living in your mind room forever, thinking the same thoughts, repeating the same opinions, remembering the same hurts. It's time to throw open the windows and let a cleansing breeze blow through. That breeze will clear the air of worry and despair and clear your mind of all those thoughts that aren't serving you. In order to throw open those windows, you first need to install them. Let's visualize that right now. Shut your eyes and picture your mind room. If you can't quite picture it, just picture it indistinctly. Its contours will become clearer as we proceed. For now, just feel it, all its stuffiness and airlessness. Now, pick a wall and install a pair of windows. Choose any sort of window you like, and have them look out onto any sort of vista you like. What windows will you choose? And what vista? My wife and I once rented a ground floor apartment in Paris with tall living room windows that opened onto a lovely, quiet side street. Seated at the table by those windows, eating baguettes and drinking wine, we watched the world go by. The windows installed in my mind room are those tall French windows. What sort of windows would you like to install? Windows looking down on Broadway with jazz playing in the background? Old-fashioned windows with screens on them looking out onto a lake? Exotic windows looking out at sand dunes and the sea beyond? Choose yours now. Now, throw them wide open. If your mind room is like most mind rooms, it is stuffy, troubling, and much too familiar. It's full of secrets that we keep from others and secrets that we keep from ourselves. It's full of intimations of our own mortality, whispers of insults not forgotten, strange, destructive urges, and ghosts of the distant past. It is anything but light and airy. Now, you get to transform that dark place into a space that is lighter and airier. With your windows thrown wide open, let all that mustiness blow away. When you add windows to your mind room, throw them open, and let a welcome breeze blow through, you immediately relax, reduce your anxiety, and provide a way for sadness to escape. You make life feel less stale, repetitive, and oppressive, just like that. You can picture regrets and disappointments leaving, and you can find peace without having to engage in soothing peace substitutes, like endlessly surfing the net or drinking too much alcohol. When I throw open the windows of my mind room, I receive amazing benefits. I feel calmer and more loving, and I think more clearly. Everything changes for the better, just as life changes for the better when a cloud passes and the sun reappears. The Buddha's advice to get a grip on your mind suggests work. It is certainly work that cognitive therapists are suggesting when they ask you to engage in thought stopping, thought substituting, and so on. But adding windows and opening them wide is easy. It's, well, a breeze. Please take a few moments and visualize your mind room filled with cheery light and a gentle breeze. Just be there. There's nothing to think about and nothing to do. Just throw those windows open and let a breeze blow through. I've written 50 books, and I know what writing a book takes. It takes the opposite of claustrophobia. It takes airiness, a breeze, and a blue sky. It takes concentration, but while swinging in a hammock. It takes focus, but as in a sea gaze. To write well, I need the mental equivalent of a still summer afternoon with the sounds of bees buzzing and air circulating. And I can have that. All I need to do is visit my mind room and throw open the window. Let's do some right thinking to go along with that new breeziness. Let's support your intention to get rid of all that stuffiness by thinking some new thoughts that will serve you. Think one of your customary unhelpful thoughts, like, I'm not very talented, or I've wasted a lot of time in life, or I'm feeling very sad. At the same time, picture those open windows, feel a gentle breeze blow through, and exclaim, silently or out loud, breeze, take this thought away. Watch the thought float right out the window. Follow it in your mind's eye all the way to the sea and watch it evaporate in shafts of sunlight. Can you even remember the thought that you were thinking? No. It floated off and is gone because you installed windows and gave it a way to exit. This is your new learning. You can always visit your mind room, indwell there peacefully, and have the thoughts that aren't serving you drift right out the windows you've installed. Thinking about playing another video game? Visit your mind room and let that craving drift off. Feeling sad? Visit your mind room and let that feeling float away. Those windows really are a bit of a miracle. They let everything you don't need pass right out of your mind room and dissolve into the ether. In the next chapter, we'll get an easy chair installed in your mind room. How nice it will be to sit in your easy chair with a lovely breeze blowing the cobwebs away. But before we leave this chapter, I want you to visit your mind room one last time. Go there now and picture a sunny day, your windows thrown open and a gentle breeze blowing through. Shut your eyes, be there, and relax. This is the first major change in how you indwell without all the usual stuffiness. Be there for a while and enjoy the experience. There's no rush. Take a moment to indwell peacefully before moving on to the next chapter. Every chapter will end with a visualization and a writing prompt. I hope you'll engage with both. Visualization. Visualize the room that is your mind. Add windows. Open those windows. Let a breeze blow in. Writing prompt. Look around your mind room. Do you see a piece of furniture or something else that ought to be removed? What is it, and why should you get rid of it? Chapter 2. Adding an easy chair. I hope you're getting comfortable with our metaphor of the room that is your mind, or as we're now calling it, your mind room. That is such an interesting place, in part because it is where our human nature plays itself out. We do not come into the world a blank slate. We come into the world human, with instincts, proclivities, orientations, potentialities, and everything else that's part of our original nature or personality. Think for a moment about how your original nature or personality might manifest as you go about redesigning your mind room. How might it get in the way? You install windows, open them, and let in a breeze. But what if your original nature finds that uncomfortable? Maybe because of some archaic fear of open windows? So, some force that you can't see or reckon with suddenly closes those windows. You enter your mind room, throw open the windows, and they suddenly slam shut again. Isn't that going to feel really strange? Ghosts, poltergeists. I think you can sense how dynamic and fundamentally strange your mind room is, and how fundamentally strange human nature is. Because how we intend to live must battle the unseen demands of our original nature. Freud used the word id to describe these unseen forces, these primitive parts, these genetic deep recesses of the species. Jung used phrases like the collective unconscious and ideas like archetypes to communicate the same fundamental notion. While we'd love to redesign our minds to suit our intentions, we are bound to be partially thwarted by the strange demands of our original nature. So we have to live with this dynamic tension and stay aware of it. There is nothing to be done about the fact that we come into the world with instincts, desires, and all the rest. When a window that we just opened suddenly slams shut, let's not act too puzzled or react too dramatically. Our mind room is that sort of place. More like a haunted house than a stately library. If we are aware of that, we can live with that and reopen the window. Next, let's deal with the amazing self-unfriendliness that so many people display toward themselves. What's a partial solution to that? Getting rid of that bed of nails square in the center of your mind room and replacing it with an easy chair. I bet that right now, there is a pain-inducing bed of nails prominently positioned in the middle of your mind room. It's the one you've installed to remind yourself at all times that you've failed yourself. It's there to punish you for mangling your life. Isn't part of you certain that you deserve that bed of nails, that you should writhe in pain, and that piercing yourself on those sharp metal points is the only way to expiate your guilt? Let's get rid of it. Right now, visualize getting rid of it. Call in the haulers and get it the heck out. Watch the haulers leave with it. Pay them a little extra to destroy it so that no one finds it and thinks they deserve it. Tip the haulers handsomely and thank them profusely. They are carrying out the thing that has harmed you the most, your enduring self-indictment. It's time to sign your pardon. That bed of nails is, and always has been, a cruel and unusual punishment. Okay, it's been hauled away. Next, go online in your mind's eye and buy yourself the exact easy chair you've never permitted yourself to get. Make sure it's comfortable. Skip that chair as art that was never meant to be sat on. Get something comfy. You want an easy chair that is genuinely easy to relax in, because that ease is going to translate into better living. Take your time shopping. Picture where you'll place your easy chair in your mind room. Maybe right beside one of those windows you installed. But which one? The one facing that gorgeous view, or the one that lets in the most air? Or maybe you'll put it right next to the handy small refrigerator, if impulse snacking isn't a problem for you. Get its placement pictured, make your purchase, and wait expectantly at the door when it's due to arrive. Point the movers to exactly where you want it positioned. Then sit. Do you deserve that easy chair? Of course you do. Do you deserve it even though you've made a hash of this and a mash of that? Of course you do. Do you deserve it even though you were to blame for that terrible A, even though you were the cause of that horrible B, and even though you didn't help when it came to that awful C? Of course you do. By purchasing it and sitting in it, you are announcing that you are human and that, warts and all, you deserve some ease. You aren't after ease for its own sake. By living more easily inside, relaxing better, pestering yourself less, by finally getting off that bed of nails, you position yourself for self-improvement. It is easier to be your best you when your mind isn't being jabbed continually. Your easy chair is your place for relaxation, rejuvenation, daydreams, bursts of imagination, forgiveness, hard thinking, renewed hope, and everything else better done in an easy chair than on a bed of nails. No doubt you agree, and yet it may prove hard to part with your bed of nails. It exists in your mind because for the longest time you've been certain that you deserve it. Part of you is positive that you ought to punish yourself for all those messes, mistakes, and missteps. Maybe you have some lingering feeling that you deserve that bed of nails. You don't. Maybe something about it feels downright comfortable. Break that spell. Sleeping on that bed of nails only makes matters worse, not better. If you want to expiate your guilt, then do a good deed, say a kind word, and make a difference. It is past time to discard that bed of nails and replace it with an easy chair. Focus on this work and do not move on to another chapter until you've called the haulers. Get that bed of nails out of there. By the way, it doesn't have to be an easy chair. Maybe that isn't exactly the right image for you. If easy chairs suggest old folks and decrepitude, pick a different image. Throughout this adventure of ours, please pick images that work for you. This is the redesign of your mind room. Decorate it and design it as you like. Does a love seat better suit you than an easy chair? Then a love seat it is. When you form an intention, like replacing that bed of nails with an easy chair, there are two excellent additional steps to take after visualizing the change. One is to begin to actively think thoughts that support that intention. Here, for example, are five thoughts that support that intention. 1. No bed of nails for me. 2. I love my easy chair. 3. I am worthy. 4. Lightness and ease. 5. I am becoming more self-friendly. Imagine entering your mind room, throwing open the windows, enjoying the soft breeze, exclaiming, "I love my easy chair," and sitting down in it to think, dream, imagine, or remember. Isn't that the ticket? 2. You can support an intention by engaging in new behaviors. Here, for example, are five behaviors that support your intention to replace your usual self-pestering with a new self-friendly lightness and ease. 1. Notice which of your behaviors seems to come from a self-unfriendly place. To begin with, just notice. 2. Pick one behavior that looks to be coming from that self-unfriendly place. Give yourself the following instruction. The next time I'm about to behave in that way, I'm going to visit my mind room, get comfy in my easy chair, and see if that makes a difference. 3. When you feel yourself about to behave in that self-unfriendly way, visualize that bed of nails being hauled away. Wave goodbye to it. See if that makes a difference. 4. Repeat this process with another behavior that looks to be coming from that same self-unfriendly place. 5. Continue the process of identifying self-unfriendly behaviors and countering each with those two visualizations, the bed of nails being hauled away, and you comfy in your easy chair. Nothing is more important to change than the ways that we diminish, derail, defeat, and inflict pain on ourselves. Turn your brilliance to this subject of self-inflicted pain. You might try asking the question, why do I do that? From a different perspective, say, from one of an evolutionary biologist or an evolutionary psychologist. Hazard some fascinating guesses about why human beings engage in all that self-unfriendly self-infliction. Don't worry if those aren't your fields of expertise. Try some imaginative guessing. Your guess may be as good as the expert's. Visualization. Visualize removing your bed of nails and replacing it with an easy chair. Writing prompt. What odd bits of your original nature may you have to contend with as you try to redesign your mind room? Chapter 3. Putting up new wallpaper. Right behind your everyday thoughts and feelings, even when those thoughts and feelings are relatively lighthearted and self-friendly, there may reside a constant background coloration of sadness. That's true for an awful lot of people. It's as if they'd painted the walls of their mind room the most depressing shade of gray imaginable, or soot from a coal fire had continually deposited itself on those walls since they were little children. What can be done about all that background sadness? Well, put up new wallpaper, of course. First, let's get those walls prepped and get all that soot off. Fire up your power washer and clean those walls. Watch all that soot disappear down the drain. It's lucky that in your mind room you can power wash your walls without getting anything wet. There go a lifetime of regrets and disappointments. There go the failures, the harm done to you, the sludge of missed opportunities and broken promises. Isn't it quite something to see those walls clean again? Now, pick out your new wallpaper. Pull out some gorgeous imaginary wallpaper books. Sit in your easy chair and peruse the patterns. Floral ones, Victorian ones, graphical ones, ones that remind you of Mondrian. Hyper-modern ones, gothic ones, super simple ones, ornate ones resembling cake decorations. What shall it be? Which one cheers you up and warms your heart the most? That's the one. Hanging real wallpaper is no easy feat, but hanging this wallpaper is a breeze. Watch it go up without a wrinkle or bubble in sight. While you're at it, throw open your windows and let a good breeze float in. If wallpaper doesn't do it for you, then paint your walls some colors you love. Create exactly the bright, cheerful walls you want. This is your room, and you can paint it or wallpaper it any way you like. There's more to do, too, in addition to putting up new wallpaper or painting your walls, if you want to get rid of a lifetime of sadness. Let's summarize a bit. You've installed windows so as to let in a breeze, some fresh air, and some fresh thoughts. Throwing open those windows will help with the sadness. We got rid of that bed of nails and replaced it with an easy chair. Surely that easy chair will make for a happier mental environment. and we have many more things to try in the coming chapters that will help reduce that background sadness. Each of these efforts will help you improve the landscape of your mind. The major shift I'm suggesting is the shift from the idea that you are merely a creature who thinks thoughts to the truer idea that you can enter into a brilliant new relationship with your own brain. By employing the metaphor of a room, by visualizing that room and its contents, and by stocking it with what you need and deserve, bright walls, an easy chair, windows that open, and all the rest, you get yourself mentally healthy and keep yourself that way. Most people live in a cell and are their own jailer. You can switch out that prison cell for a room as pleasant, beautiful, and functional as you would like to make it. I hope you like the wallpaper you chose, and if you don't, switch it right out. Visualization. Visualize repainting or repapering the walls of your mind room so that it is a more cheerful place to inhabit. Writing prompt. How will you keep track of the changes that you're making to your mind room? Give that some thought and write on that theme. Chapter 4. Installing a safety valve. Let's step back for a moment. You understand that we are not actually moving furniture or stripping walls. Mind room is a metaphor. Because it is a metaphor, it provides us with maximum flexibility. One listener might want to consider all of the changes that I'm suggesting and make all of them. Another listener might focus on making one specific change or running with one particular idea. From my point of view, if you really engage with even just one of these visualizations, for instance, getting rid of that bed of nails and replacing it with an easy chair, you will have done yourself a world of good. This chapter's visualization is a case in point. If you get clear on the idea I'm about to discuss and you make use of that visualization, you will greatly reduce your stress levels. Human beings find themselves pressured in all sorts of ways. And these pressures are experienced as pressure, as the sort of pressure that brings on migraines. To simply and brilliantly deal with these real and insistent pressures, install a release valve somewhere in your mind room. You might visualize this as releasing the pressure from a pressure cooker, releasing steam from a boiler, or opening a vacuum-sealed can and enjoying that familiar pop. Take a moment and consider how you might want to visualize releasing pressure. Try to get a clear.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.